So this series of lectures will be given by Gilles Courtois. I don't remember the title, but it's about the finiteness of Gromov hyperbolic spaces. Something similar. Okay, Gilles,
thank you very much. So, good morning to everybody. So, the topic of the course is extracted from a joint work. With my dear friends Gérard Besson, Sylvain Gallo, and Andrea Sandizetti. Is it large enough?
Yes, it's very good.
And there are notes of this lecture which you can find on. Salut Bruno. Which you can find on app.
The number is 0322. Je viens d'envoyer. Donc, Julien, je vais le garder.
Bruno, tu peux couper ton micro, s'il te plaît. Bruno, tu peux couper ton micro, s'il te plaît.
Okay, so the topic of the course is to study a particular set of metric spaces. Let's say M. Which will be set of metric spaces, as I said, with some additional assumption of geometrical nature. And the game will be to say that such a class has some strong constraint if I give some appropriate assumption. So, for example, the example of things we have in mind is, for example, show that such a class endowed with Gromov Hausdorff distance, I will come back to this later. It's compact. Such a set admits only finitely many topological types of underlying space. So M contains finitely many topological types. And these are the two main features we would like to study. And of course, the game will be to get the strongest restriction on these spaces with the weakest assumption here. Okay, so there are two famous results of this nature. So examples of such a restriction. First one is the famous theorem of Gromov, which says that if M is a set of Riemannian manifold of dimension n, with with Ricci curvature, let's say bounded below by some number, and with diameter bounded above by some constant. So these are the geometric assumptions. Then this space endowed with the Gromov other distance is pre-compact. Which means that, which essentially means that every sequence of Riemannian manifold with this assumption will eventually converge to some metric space. Okay. All right. So the second famous result is: are there? Don't hesitate to ask questions. Of course, if I go too fast or if I say something which you do not understand. The second. Famous theorem under this line, and one has to keep these two results in mind all along the lecture. Is the finite Klebsch-Zieger theorem, which says that if M is a set of Riemannian manifold with sectional curvature bounded by some number and diameter. So bounded above by some number, and volume of M bounded below by some positive constant, then this set contains only finitely many differentiable type of manifold. So they exist. So M contains only finitely many differentiable type of manifold, which means that there exists a finite list of differentiable manifold, such that every Riemannian manifold which supports the metric with this assumption is diffeomorphic to one of them. Okay. Okay, so as I said, our game will be to give rise to some this kind of statement, but for a class of metric spaces, where we will go out of the class of Riemannian manifold. So the spaces we will consider will be just metric spaces. And about this curvature assumption, we will also try to introduce weaker assumption of the curvature. Okay. So what is the setup? So maybe I will briefly introduce the object that we are going to study. So first of all, the metric space we will consider all the time are proper metric spaces. Proper means that the closed balls are compact, first of all. And a class which will interest me particularly is the class of geodesic length space. So length space, so probably everybody knows what it is, but I just recall it quickly. Just tell me if it's not this way. So length metric space. Is a space such that for every pair of points, there exists a rectifiable curve C, which joins these two points. And rectifiables means that the length of C is finite, where the length is by definition the sup of the sum of the distance between C of Ti and C of Ti plus one among all subdivision of 0, 1. Okay? And space will be, the length space will be geodesic space. If for any pair of points in this space, there exists a curve, a geodesic, let's say, between x and y. A geodesic means a rectifiable curve, rectifiable curve, such as the length, let's say c, such as its length. Okay, so now the set of, so we will we'll be interested by another, I mean, we don't want to look at all of geodesic metric space, but one class of particular interest for you, for us, is the following. So Gromov hyperbolic. Space. Sorry, I have to write in our space. So we are going to consider a geodesic space, YD, and we are looking at all geodesic triangles. So for any three points, I am going to choose a geodesic adjoining the three points, so to come up with a triangle. And given such a triangle, I consider a tripod which is such a wide picture with the property that if let's say A, C, and B are the length of the side, then the length, so you look at this triangle, at this tripod as a triangle, a particular triangle, kind of degenerate triangle, and so the length, the side of length C, B, and A. And I claim that, and I let you verify this as an exercise. I claim that there exists a point here and a point there and over there, which divided each of the sides, let's say in the length U. So the two lengths here are equal. So here I call them V, and there, so it's another length, and there. And this length will correspond to U, B, and W. So the claim, the exercise is shows that there exist three points there, or there exist U, V, and W. Given A, B, C, there exists just a decomposition, which allows to say that if you consider now a map which map isometrically this triangle to this one, then the condition of Gromov hyperbolicity is, do you see if I write here? So the metric space YD will be defined as delta hyperbolic if for any t in the tripod T, then the diameter of T is less than delta. Okay? The diameter of F minus the inverse image of this point is less than T. Okay? So what is the diameter of F minus 1 of T? So for example, take a point T here, then the inverse image is two points here, and the condition says that the distance between these two points in Y is less, is uniformly bounded by some number of delta. Okay. And for example, this other point here in the middle, it has three points in its inverse image. And again, all these lengths here are less than delta. Okay. So somehow you could formulate this condition saying that the triangle you see here are in some sense not far from being a triangle in a tree, like in this tripod, or you could formulate this saying that the triangle are thin, delta thin. Okay, so this is an exercise to show existence of this UV and W. And I let you do it. So are there questions so far? So for all this definition on hyperbolic spaces, I refer you to there are several books. There is a book of Brighton and Fliger, let's say, which contains everything, and also Delzan, Papadopoulos, and Nicola. All right, so the example of hyperbolic space. So hyperbolic space, or all, for example, the hyperbolic space is delta hyperbolic. So the Euclidean space is not a tree. Which is a graph without a cycle, it is zero hyperbolic. Okay. This is because triangle in a tree look like this, and for this kind of triangle, you can take the value of delta being zero. Okay, so we will be also concerned with, I forgot to say something. So there is another characterization which will be very useful for us of the delta hyperbolicity. Which is a quadrangle inequality. And the quadrangle inequality, is related to four points. So you take four points in your metric space, and you look at the quadrangle with its diagonals. Okay, and the quadrangle condition says that that the distance between, say, x, z plus distance between y, w, so the sum of these two distances, okay, is less than or equal to the max of so the two other possibilities, so to speak, so the distance between x and y plus the distance between z and w, and distance between x and w plus the distance between z plus that. So this condition, which is that for any quadrupole of points, when has this inequality, is equivalent to being delta hyperbolicity.
Si tu écris à cheval sur deux tableaux, ça pose un problème.
OK, I'm sorry.
Oh,
no problem, so you have to look.
Okay, so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. people can see the full world.
The condition is the following. So the distance between x, z, the distance between y, w is less than the max. The distance between x and y plus distance between z and w and distance between x and w plus distance between z and y plus 2 delta. And you can, so I let you do this exercise, which is, you can find in the textbook I mentioned to you. It's a good exercise to do, but you can also, maybe it's better to each time I say something on delta hyperbolic space, you can try to check this relation with delta equals zero for a tree, for example. Okay. And if you are in the case of a tree, then everything can be computed because you know that there exists just one geodesic between any pair of points, and you can just look and check that this formula is correct with delta equals zero. All right. Okay. So now our metric spaces. Let me change the notation just to, because it's fun to change. So now our geodesic metric space XD, we will equip it with a Borel measure, which is a measure on Borel subset, and which is finite on compact subset. Okay, so for example, for example, if X Riemannian manifold, you can take as a measure the Riemannian volume, but we will be more interested in other kind of measure. For example, if P I is a discrete set of points, then mu equals the sum of the Dirac mass at this point is also a very interesting measure, and we'll come back to this in 1 minute. And also, if X is a graph, then you will choose mu to be the Lebesg measure on the edges. Okay. So these are just examples. Okay, so now we are considering metric space and with measures, and we will consider also action of group. So group action. So ask the action to be proper, so I will consider proper isometric action, which means that gamma is a subgroup of the isometric group of X. And proper means that for any X, the set of gamma in gamma, that the distance between X and gamma X is less than R. Okay. Cardinal of this set is finite. Okay. And given such an action, there will be a very interesting measure, which will be the counting measure. So the counting measure is will be in all this course. Our most favorite measure, so mu x gamma. So x is some point in x, and gamma is the proper action on x. And mu x gamma is is the sum of the Dirac mass on the point on the orbit of gamma of x. determines. You look at the orbit of X. So X is somewhere in the space. The orbit is discrete because the action is proper, and and you come up with this measure. And if you look at and to this counting measure is associated with the counting function. The counting function, which is mu x gamma of the whole of center x and radius r, which is the number of gamma in gamma, such that the distance between x and gamma x is less than r. Okay. Can you see here? So, other questions so far? Not just definition. So maybe if you need to.
Ah, merci. Qu'est-ce qu'il pouvait faire?
Démarrer la vidéo.
Mais ça, je ne sais pas faire.
Vidéo qui s'est coupée tout à
l'heure.
Ouais. C'est bon. Ok, c'est bon.
Ok, so. All right, so. Now, maybe I switch a little bit. I recall you. So the last part of this lecture will be devoted to proving in this context of metric space, of delta hyperbolic metric space, an action of group on this metric space, a version of the Bishop-Gromov inequality. So let me just recall you what the Bishop-Gromov inequality is in the context of Riemannian inequality. What does it say? It says the following. So you consider a complete Riemannian manifold. And you assume that the Ricci curvature of M is larger than maybe I don't want to change my notation. Okay, so n minus one. So n is a dimension, so n minus one lambda yeah. And so lambda is some real number. And and you now consider the volume with respect to the Riemannian volume. So here you have a canonical volume associated to this data, and you consider now the volume of some ball. So x is some point m, and you consider the ratio between the volume of a ball of center x and radius r divided by the volume. So this is the volume with respect to g, and now it will be the volume with respect to g lambda. So I will explain what it is in 1 second. So b lambda of r. So what is b lambda of r? So maybe here. So I will call M lambda to be the simply connected manifold of constant sectional curvature equal to lambda. Okay? So if lambda is plus one, it is a sphere. If lambda is minus one, it is a hyperbolic space. And if lambda is equal to zero, it's a Euclidean space. And in these spaces, a ball of radius r doesn't depend on the point. So it has a volume. And the Bishop-Gromov inequality tells you that this is non-increasing. It's a non-increasing function of r. So there are two consequences of this theorem. There are many consequences of this theorem, two immediate consequences. The first consequence is noticing that when r tends to zero, then all metric looks like Euclidean metric, and so this ratio tends to one when r tends to zero, because the volume of small balls are the same in every manifold. It's like the Euclidean volume, okay? And therefore, you can deduce from that the volume of B with respect to G of B XR is less than the volume lambda of B lambda R for any R, okay? And the second inequality is that the volume for G of B X R divided by the volume of the ball of small r. So now r is any little r and capital R are just two positive numbers. And then this number is less than volume lambda of B lambda R divided by volume lambda of B lambda small r. Okay. And in fact, these two immediate consequences of this statement, okay, just convince you that it is immediate, and it is. These two consequences have a lot of application in geometry, and we will see some of them all along the lecture. Okay? So it's a very important tool which allows. So it could seem weak because it's just an information on the growth of the volume of balls, but you will see that it is very strong and it can control Betti numbers and topological information on the manifold. So it seems weak, but in fact it is really strong, and we will see how in the course of the lecture. So some remark about this statement. Maybe not now. Maybe later. I don't know. Another thing I would like to say. So I completely forgot to define in this part of what I say on the metric space. I forgot to say something. So maybe I just add it here now. Okay. So I will write the other application here. But I need another. Another invariant in all this story, which is the entropy. I forgot to speak about this. So I come back to the setting of metric spaces with a measure, Borel measure, as before. Okay, and with this, so what we call the entropy of x d mu, by definition, it is a lim 1 that r converges to infinity of 1 over r. So it's a volume entropy log of mu of ball of r. Okay? So I put a lim 1 so that I have no problem. And you can do this easy exercise. I'm sorry.
On va mettre la vidéo. 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 Ah oui. Normalement, je voulais dire.
Bon. Je sais pas pourquoi il saute.
Ouais, c'est bizarre.
C'est bon.
Ok.
So, exercise. Now, if you have a proper action on PD new, so this symbol means that gamma acts isometrically and also preserving the measure. Okay, so gamma preserves the measure mu, and if there is a proper group action preserving the measure on x, and if x not gamma is compact, then this lim half is actually a limit. Okay, the lim half. Okay, so I didn't say that in this definition you have to check that what you are computing here is independent of the choice of the base. Okay. It is also an easy exercise. Okay. So are there questions so far? So if not, I add the remark I wanted to do about as a consequence of the Bishop-Gromov inequality. So now if M is a Riemannian manifold with Ricci larger than N minus 1 lambda, then the entropy, think of M as a complete non-compact manifold. If M is compact, the entropy is 0. So then the entropy of M, I should say dvg here to glue to this definition. So then the entropy is larger than n minus one lambda. Sorry, smaller because of this inequality. And So if let's say that lambda negative, okay. So if lambda is positive, then the manifold is compact, and then the entropy is zero. So this statement is interesting when lambda is non-positive, and in this case, okay. So it's without any assumption. Okay, thank you. So if lambda is positive, then you have so you have to think that if lambda is for example one, so the Ricci is larger than the Ricci of the hyperbolic space, and the entropy is smaller than the entropy of the hyperbolic space. Okay. And if lambda is equal to zero, then the Ricci is positive or zero, and the volume of balls is polynomial, and then you come up with zero. Okay. So it's coherent with no need to make the assumption and lambda. Okay?
Yeah? Question about entropy. So yeah. We define the entropy like as a function from x to r that takes the number limit of r log. And we said that in the exercise we have the same convergence.
Here there is a lim half.
Yeah.
Okay. Here there is if without any assumption you have to put the limit, there could have no limit of this quantity when R goes to infinity. You can go through the example. This is when the geometry is highly inhomogeneous, if it changes when you tends to infinity, you construct example looking at annuli and change the metric, and here you could have no limit, and but the exercise is saying that the limit is a limit when you have a group which acts co-compact. Other question? Okay, so now I can state the main theorem of today. So SD will be a delta hyperbolic space. We will have a proper action, and we will make the assumption, two assumptions. The quotient is by this action is compact, so the diameter of H is less, not gamma is less than D, and the entropy, so as I said, okay, so, and the entropy of X, D, so okay, so I should have said something again here, so maybe I add a remark here, okay? So maybe I do the remark after, okay? So the entropy of XD is less than H. So you have to explain this assumption a bit more precisely. Then, for any R prime less than R, so let me just write and I comment that after. So there is some assumption. So these are radii of balls, and the balls have to be not too small, and not too small compared to the assumption, so the diameter and the type of hyperbolicity. And then one has this Bishop-Gromov-like inequality. So mu x gamma, I recall you that it is a counting measure, and you have here the measure of the ball of radius constant. So R so maybe I'm sorry, so there are two statements. So now I am considering two radii, and the smallest being bigger than 10 D plus 2 delta.
There are some comments about these inequalities, which I will in a minute tell you.
Yeah.
So you probably have to assume that lambda is positive. Otherwise, you get
in this inequality.
Yeah.
Positive.
Yes. Otherwise, you get a contradiction because the second inequality might be with a negative number.
Okay, let me just make a comment on this. So making this assumption that lambda is positive is not a restriction, because if she has some lower bound, you can always write it this way. Okay, and what you have to keep in mind is a case where lambda, for example, is equal to one. Okay, and in this case, you compare with a real hyperbolic space. So Ricci equal minus n minus 1 is a Ricci curvature of the real hyperbolic space. And in this case, the entropy is less than the entropy of the
hyperbolic. The negative is okay. The negative is okay. But not negative. That's a comment.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you for the comment.
It's not my comment.
Thank you to the author of the room. Okay. So let me go back to this statement. CRM. Okay, so now I have two radii, and the smallest is larger than some fixed quantity, which depends on the parameter. And one has this this Bishop-Gromov ratio, and the theorem tells you that it is less than, so there are some constant, so I will write it C delta HD, and you can make this function write this function as a formula. So it's not very important what is the formula, but I write it down because this is what we get. So the important thing here is that this number depends, the bound depends only on the radius that you are choosing, and also on the bound on the entropy of the space and on the diameter. Okay, so the good thing about this statement is that it goes further the case of Riemannian manifold. And so you have this assumption, the space has to be hyperbolic, and you have a group which has to act, on it, and the space has to have not so large entropy. And let me just make some comment about how to compare this statement to the original one in some sense. So as I said here, when the Ricci curvature is bounded below, then the entropy is bounded above. Okay? And therefore, imposing a lower bound on Ricci curvature is a stronger assumption than imposing a condition on the entropy. So this can be seen as a weak assumption on the lower bound of curvature. Okay? Bounded by below the entropy is like bounded by above the entropy is like bounded by below the curvature. Okay, and we have to have a compact quotient for the final squeeze. Okay, and another remark that should be done here is that this estimate is absolutely non-optimal. When R tends to infinity, you can compute example. You can, for example, look at the case of hyperbolic space and look at what is here. So for the hyperbolic space, you can compute H and you can take various radia, R and capital R and small r, and check that this is this inequality, of course, all, but it is in fact much better in concrete example. So it's not sharp at all, but the good thing about it is that it is true for every such in this class of metric space. Okay? This is the idea of all this. Okay, so this theorem. So maybe I will spend some time proving it. So are there questions about the statement first? Before I start to making this a proof. So I won't prove this as it is written. I will prove an easier version, and this will be an easy consequence of the one I'm going to write now. So the second theorem has the same assumption. So you start with the delta hyperbolic space, a proper action. And we assume, as usual, that the diameter x mod gamma is less than d, and the entropy of x d is less than h. Okay. The conclusion is that for any x, for any larger than 12 delta, then nu x gamma of d x r divided by nu x gamma of d x pi r over 6 less than 1 plus 2 e h r. Okay? So the important thing is that phi r over 6 is strictly smaller than r. And in fact, in order to deduce that statement from this, you just iterate this inequality in order to get this basic. So this computation is trivial, but I don't want to do. And we are now focusing on proving this. And okay, so here we go. So should one, is there a break which is
you can decide that there is a break.
I don't know. Are you tired, or maybe you can make a five minute break. And
okay, everybody. Okay, everybody. So there is a 5 minute break. So don't leave the room or any room or wherever you are. And okay, in 5 minutes would be okay. That's fine. Merci.
Tell me if it's not a break.
No. But you can do whatever you want to have.
No, but for
this 90 minutes, you have a post. Éventuellement. Ça va bien, mais... Non, mais toi, je me gêne pas pour te dire ça. Si, parce que on a tendance à être fatigué.
Il y a des questions?
C'est un art.
Et un art, c'est 4-0.
I rewrite,
we need all the boards, so I rewrite the second theorem here.
Yeah. Okay, we are back to work.
Okay, so I have, for those who was not here, so I have written again the theorem we want to prove now here on the left hand side of the board. And so let's start proving this. The proof is pretty long, so I have tried to divide it into several steps, and we try to keep the value step in this maybe the part of this board. The first step is some claim. The claim is the following: so in all what follows, mu will be mu x gamma. Okay, the counting measure that we have defined. Okay, and the claim is the following. So for any r prime r such that, so the bound I have given, so r prime and r are two numbers which are larger than 12d plus 2 delta. And the claim is that for all such numbers, then one has some relation star, which is that mu, so which is a counting measure of b x r divided by mu of b x 5 r over 6, which is the quantity I want to estimate in terms of the entropy here. So this term is less than the mu, the measure of b x. I will draw a picture in a minute. So maybe I need some, I don't have the right to cross. I can cross the line.
Not the board.
Okay, so r plus r prime minus b, so there is a bracket here, minus b x r minus r prime over 2 divided by mu of E x r minus b x r minus r prime over 2. So as I said, this is the left hand side of the theorem, and this is a ratio of the volume of the measure of annuli. Okay, so let me just draw a picture maybe here. So so here I have x. Here I have the radius, so I have three concentric balls. Okay, so the smallest is of radius r minus r prime over 2. The second one is of radius r, and the third one is r plus r prime. Okay, and so this quantity, in fact, measures the growth of how annuli are growing when you change the radii. And in fact, so also in this inequality, it's good to think of r prime fixed, let's say, as it is in the statement, and r being very large. Okay, r will tend to infinity, and r is fixed. Okay, and the idea is that from this we are going to compute from this annuli, we are going to compute the to make appear the entropy So what is exactly this ratio? So the numerator, at the numerator, it is exactly the measure of this annulus, okay? And at the denominator, one has a measure of the smallest. So this ratio exactly controls the growth, I mean the exponential growth, so to speak, of the annuli. Okay. All right. So it is in the proof of this property that we will need the assumption of delta hyperbolicity. Let me just postpone the proof of this and start explaining to you why this claim implies the theorem. Okay. So first of all, why do the claim implies the theorem? And the idea is to apply the claim So let me just state the notation. So I will write AK be the volume of the measure of the ball of radius K R prime over 2. Okay. And I will also set 1 plus C being the term that I want to estimate, the ratio between volume of ball of radius R prime. So let me just add a prime here, okay? So there are two radii here, R prime and R, and on the left hand side, this is a term which appears in the theorem, but with a prime. Okay, it's not very important. So maybe it's not a good idea to have change notation. It is how it is now. So 1 plus C is exactly the ratio I want to estimate. Okay. Now we write. So we set this, and now we write R for R prime as it is. It is fixed, and R we call K R prime over 2. Okay. So for this particular case, what is R plus R prime? R plus R prime is just K plus 2 R prime over 2, and what is R minus R prime? It is K minus 1 R prime over 2. Okay. Just by definition. All right, so now the claim applied to R prime and R equal K R prime over 2, okay, gives, let me just write again the claim, mu of B X 5 R prime over 6 divided by mu B X, R prime. R prime over 6 is less than so these are annuli, okay, so, and I have computed R plus R prime and R minus R prime, and so I come up with A K plus 2 minus A K minus 1 divided by A K minus A K minus 1. You follow me? Just okay. And this has been set as 1 plus C. Okay? And therefore, I come up with 1 plus C times AK minus 1 less than AK plus 2 minus AK minus 1. Okay? And if you look at this, this inequality in the eyes, what you get is AK plus 2. So you see the AK minus 1 disappear, okay? And you can put the AK here on this side. So AK plus 2 minus AK larger than C times AK minus AK minus 1. Okay? Is that right? Okay. And now what you do is, as usual, just keep track of my notes just to see that I didn't. Okay. All right, so now, as usual, I sum up for k in 2n, and you can check that you come up with c an minus a1 here, so the same concept, and is less than. A n plus 2 plus a n plus 1 minus a 3 minus a 1. So here, when you sum up everything, you have k and k plus 2, so things appears by 2 by 2, two following terms by 2, so you come up with this. And since A is an increasing function, then you can bound this above by 2 A n plus 2 minus A, A1. Okay. So this term is larger than this one and the other way around. Okay. I replace A3 by E1 because A is increasing. Okay. Okay, and again, iterating this inequality, you come up with a. So I iterate this, and I come up with a. I apply it to 2n, and I get a2n minus a1 larger than c over 2. So the c over 2 is coming from here. To so the n minus 1, an minus a1. Okay. So it's a bit of computation, but okay, it has to be done. And I could add that this is smaller than a to n. Okay? It's a bit annoying, but okay, so maybe I can erase this. And now I am done because I'm done. I mean, I can deduce from this what I wanted because A2n, I recall that A2n is the measure of the ball of center x and radius 2n r prime over 2. Okay? And therefore, the entropy xd, which we know is less than h by assumption, okay, it is the limit when n tends to plus infinity of 1 over, so this is sequence of ball of radius n r prime. So when n tends to infinity, the entropy is exactly the limit of 1 over n r prime of the log of the measure of the ball of radius n r prime. This is just the definition of the entropy. And so this term here is just A2n. And from this inequality here, I come up with the bound, which is that it is larger than log c over 2 plus is it 1 over r prime, so the n cancel, so 1 over r prime, the n cancel with this one, and it takes the log, and there is also 1 over n r prime log of a2 minus a1, okay? So this tends to zero. So there is some remark, there are some questions that you have to ask me now, and this is the inequality you get, and from this you deduce that that C is bounded above by E to H R prime, okay? And because of the definition of C, you come up with the fact that mu of B X R prime divided by mu of B X R 5 R prime over 6 is less than 1 plus 2, so it is 1. C over 2 here, so you have 2 here, 2, which is what you wanted to prove. And here there is something you shouldn't be happy with, which is that I have taken the log of C and the log of A2 minus A1, and so you have to check that these numbers are positive. And I let you do this as an exercise, but the idea is that C is a ratio of two volumes, more or less, okay, and so you have to, so C plus one, so this is C plus one, and so you need to, in order to be able to take the log of C, you need to show that this number is strictly positive, and this is true because of the assumption on R prime, which says that in this annulus r prime is 5 r prime over 6, there is a ball of radius d, and then you have element inside. Okay, so same thing for a2 minus a1. Okay, so you have to say something, but it's not very complicated. So it so this shows that the claim implies a theorem. Okay, so now one has to show the claim. So I get the claim here and I'm here. Are there questions? Or all right? Can I erase here? So proof of the claim. The proof of the claim will rely on several lemmas. Okay, and so the claim is here, and now I write lemma one here. And this lemma is a geometric lemma. It is a delta hyperbolic lemma. So what does this lemma say? This way. Okay, so it says that in a delta hyperbolic space, when two balls of different radius intersect, then the intersection is small in some sense that you can quantify. Okay, this is the idea, and so it measures intersection of both. And what are we saying here? So we have a delta hyperbolic space. Usual, one has two numbers r and r prime, two positive numbers, okay, and one has two points x and y in the space, and we assume that the distance between x and y is strictly smaller than r plus r prime, and we draw a picture in 1 second, and the claim is that the ball of centered at x and of radius r, intersected with the ball centered at y and radius r prime, is contained. So it claims the lemma says that there exists some y prime in x, this intersection of balls is contained in the ball centered on y prime and of small radius. And the small radius is something that you can compute. R is the minimum of R prime and one half of R prime plus R minus distance between X and Y. Plus two delta. Okay, so there are three terms, R prime, and this quantity, okay, with the two delta at the end. Okay. Okay, so it's a bit. So, okay. Maybe I won't have time to finish everything. I can prove this, okay, because it is a geometric statement. So, what is the picture? So, the picture is the following. You have x somewhere, and you have y, okay? And, okay, so, there are two cases. So, let me just assume that one radius is smaller than the other one, so, okay. And so d, I will call d the distance between x and y, and it is smaller than r plus r prime. This condition implies that the two balls are intersecting non-trivially. And there are two cases, basically. One case is when d is smaller than r minus r prime. Okay, so what does it say? It says that in this case, so you have R somewhere here. So it says that the ball of radius R prime centered at Y is included in the ball of radius R centered at X, okay? Because this is D. And saying that d is smaller than r minus r prime tells you that you have this increment, because if some point here is at a distance less than r prime from y, then the distance between x and z it is smaller than d plus r prime, which is smaller than r. Okay, so you are in this case, and in this case there is nothing to say, because also in this case the term R here, in fact, is equal to R prime. So in that case, you can verify that this term small r is exactly this one, because if you compute this one, you have to check that this term is larger than. So maybe to simplify, because time is running, I will do the proof in the case of a tree. For the general case, just move a little bit the tree and come up with an atomic space, but it's the same proof. Okay. So what I'm claiming now is that in this case, small r is equal to r prime, because the term which is here, one half r plus r prime minus d. So now delta is zero, it's not important. This term is, under this assumption, is larger than one half r plus r prime minus r plus r prime, which is exactly r prime. Okay? So it's completely trivial that in that easy case, you can take y prime equal y and b y prime r to be y r prime. Okay. So in some sense, it is a non-interesting case. Okay. So the second case, which is the case where something happened, is a case where d is larger than r minus r prime. Okay. So in this case, small r, exactly for the same reason here, say that in this case, R will be this term. The computation I have done here, when you reverse this inequality, gives exactly that R is equal to this term. Okay? This term is larger than R prime. So maybe so in this case, R is equal to 1/2 of R plus R prime minus D. Just because this term is smaller than R prime, which is smaller than R. Okay. Just check it. Okay, so in this case, what is the point? So this case corresponds to the picture, to the following picture. So it corresponds to the case where you have X. Y and the ball of radius R prime, and here the ball of radius R. Okay, and the idea is that Y prime will be the point in the middle of this sector here. Okay, so let me just write it down here. So let's consider the geodesic C such that C of 0 equal X, C of D equal Y, so D is the distance between X and Y, and Y prime will be C of the middle here, and what is the middle here? It is 1/2 of R plus D minus R prime, and if I'm correct, okay? I should write it minus R prime plus D, okay? I think it's okay. Okay, so now I want to show, what do we want? We want to show that B one prime R, so R is this term, and we want to show that this ball contains B X R intersection B Y R prime. So I take a point Z in this thing, in this intersection of ball, and I want to show that it is here. And to show this, I apply. So I have the following picture. So I take a point Z. Here in the intersection, and I see a quadrangle appearing here. The quadrangle x, z, y prime, y. Okay, and I will apply the quadrangle inequality, and that's where we will use delta hyperbolicity. I have assumed, just to simplify, that delta is equal to zero, and I apply the quadrangle inequality. So I start so I want, what do I want? I want to compute the distance between z and y prime, right? And I want to show that z is in this ball, and so. And so I will write the quadrangle inequality starting with these two sides of the quadrangle. And so I write D of Z Y prime, which is a guide I want to estimate, plus D of X Y is less than the maximum of. So you have to, since the quadrangle is not. It's bizarrely written. I have to take my notes. And what are the other thing I have not considered? So maybe here. So there is this other pair of sides, this one and this one. Okay. The personal one. So it is less than max of D of X Z plus Y prime Y. And the last one. It says the blue one, which is this one and this one. Okay, and which is distance between z and y plus distance between y prime and x. Now I look at what I have here, and so the distance between between x and z is smaller than r because of the assumption here, and the distance between y prime and y, I can compute it. So it is d minus it is d minus the distance between between x and y prime, which is by definition 1/2 of r minus r prime plus d. This is for the first term here. So I just continue computing this term, and this is what, look, it is so there is a d minus 1/2 of d. There is a, so there is, you come up with 1/2 of r coming from this, plus r prime from it, coming from this, and d minus plus d, if I am correct, because there is d minus, okay? And here you compute the same way. So the distance between z and y, it is less than r prime, and the distance between y prime and x, is it right? Y prime and x, it is exactly the term which is here. So 1/2 of r minus r prime plus d. Okay. And tell me if I'm wrong. So you come up with 1/2 of r.
So it's r plus r prime minus d.
Where?
Is there where you were
here?
Showing your finger just before.
Here?
1/2.
Or
yeah, here it's, I would say r plus r prime minus d.
Here?
I would say so.
Here? So it is?
Yeah, so here.
This is. Formula is not correct, that's what you say.
Like, yeah, I wouldn't know this one.
Okay. So I, this point is the middle of this guy here. Okay, so this distance here is r. So y prime, so to speak, is r plus this distance here,
right.
Divide, so it's 1/2 of r plus this distance here, okay? And this distance here is d minus r prime. It's a bit confusing because there are plus minus everywhere, but it's okay. So here I come back here, and if I am correct, you come up with a 1/2 of r, which is here, plus r prime, and again plus d. Okay, the same term as here. Okay. All right, but this term. Okay. So at the end, you come up with d distance between z and y prime is less than. So this term is d, and then it is less than 1/2 r plus r prime plus d minus d, which is exactly 1/2 of r plus r prime minus d, which is by definition r. Okay, so you have really shown that this, and so okay, so maybe I have been pretty slow, but it's not important. So it ends the proof of this, and I would like to end up, so I will end the proof tomorrow, actually. So but let me just this is the where the geometry of delta hyperbolic metric space takes place, and a good exercise to do is to understand why this lemma that we have shown, that the intersection of the ball is contained in some ball of centered at y prime and of radius r, try to so it uses strongly the quadrangle inequality. So it uses strongly the fact that the space is delta hyperbolic, so it shouldn't be true in the Euclidean space. And please do the exercise to try to show this in the Euclidean space and observe that it's not possible if you take two balls, for example, taking two balls intersecting like this, and you take the same radius of the two points, you will always end up very quickly to the fact that delta has to be infinite, that the ball has to be, you see this R, in this R there is two delta. So in some sense, this will be true, but delta is infinite in the case of Euclidean space, and so it doesn't give any valuable information, okay? So maybe it's time to end for today. And I'm sorry I didn't succeed to finish the proof, but it's maybe better to go slowly rather than to rush. And I will end up the proof of this next time. And next time we will see, so this is probably the most technical part of the course, because when I will be finishing this, after this, we will run a long application of this beautiful tool, Bishop-Bromov inequality, and you will see that you can do many things with this simple-minded comparison of volume and show the topological finiteness and things which you could see at the beginning that this assumption are not enough. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Gilles, for this lecture. So I guess there is no question because it's lunchtime. And
maybe there are questions on the chat.
And no, someone say thanks.
I have one question.
Oh, yeah, sure.
So, in fact, it seems to me that you proved when delta is not zero, you proved that in the intersection of two balls is containing B, Y prime, up, R, where small r is the number, one half r prime plus r minus b plus two delta.
So the intersection of the two balls is included in that.
But when delta is very large, the number might end up being larger than
So when r is very large, and you will see that. I mean,
yeah, so but in the case you didn't prove it for small r equal to the minimum of these numbers, because r, if delta is very large, r prime would be smaller than that.
No, I see what you mean.
Am I wrong?
No, because you have this assumption that okay. So maybe I understand what you said, but you know that. Wait. You are in the case where V is larger than. When D is larger than R minus R prime. Okay?
Yes.
So D is very large compared to, I mean, it depends. In your mind, you think of R prime being fixed, for example, and R going to infinity, if I understand well. So, but in this case, I showed that this term is smaller than this one. So here.
Okay, but without the depth.
Why do you say that? So I have done the case where delta equals to zero, but if delta is what do you say? I'm not sure I understand the point. So what I'm saying is that this implies that R equals this guy anytime. This is my claim.
Really?
Okay. R is equal to this, and I agree that I have assumed in this proof that delta is equal to zero, but just everything is the same, and in the quadrangle inequality, you just add two delta.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's nothing.
Okay.
I think it's fine.
Okay, thank you, everybody. So we'll start to get at two.
Yeah.
No, I was just also. Where did you use that inequality assumption in the proof for a claim of Reyes for delta being bounded by R prime?
This is a secret. This is the part that he left as an exercise.
Yeah, it is okay. So right, so it is when I say that some quantity had to be positive, we use this.
So you try to do it, and if you don't succeed tomorrow, we'll give you again.
I can come back to this issue tomorrow.
Yeah.
I have let a few things, but not that much. Maybe.
Okay, maybe we stop and go for lunch. And we meet again at 2 p.m. The same room for the people here and the different room for Zoom.
Okay.